Namaste and welcome to another session of Shankara Jayanti celebrations and the festival that we have been doing around oneness. My name is Prasad Kaipa. I'm hosting this session from Silicon Valley. And tonight we have two special guests. One, Sri R.S. Ravi, speaking from Singapore. He will be talking about Nirvana Satakam, and I will introduce you to Sri Ravi in a minute. And after that, for the second part of this session, we will have Geeta Chandrasekhar, and this will be a musical performance coming through video. That means for the second part, we will not have any Q&A. For R.S. Ravi, you are welcome to ask your questions through the box. We have a chat box into which if you can put questions at the end of Sri Raviji's talk, we will take your questions. So for now, I'd like to introduce Sri Raviji, who has graciously agreed to give the pravachan tonight. By the way, when I'm saying tonight, I'm speaking from the California time. I'm still in fifth evening. But Singapore, where Sri Raviji is there, as well as many of the people in India, it is good morning to you. It is sixth morning already. So R.S. Raviji is engineer by training. He is working for an MNC in Singapore. And under Swami Paramarthananda and Swami Omkarananda, he has been studying scriptures in a systematic way for more than 10 years. And he has been taking lessons for people in Singapore for about 7 years from 2013. He has been giving lectures on Gita and other Vedantic texts. And on a personal basis, he is married and he has two grown-up children. And as I mentioned, he lives in Singapore. And we are really privileged to have you, Raviji. And he will be speaking on the topic Nirvana Satakam. Raviji, the floor is yours. Thank you again for coming. And please take it away.
श्रुति स्मृति पुराणानां आलयं करुणालयं नमामि भगवत्पादं लोक शंकरं लोक शंकरं गुरुर्ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णुः गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुस्साक्षात् परं ब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां ओम Pranams to the lotus feet of the Lord, pranams to all the Gurujis and pranams to all the Mahatmas who are on the call. I am extremely happy to give this talk as part of the Shankara Jayanti celebrations. As Hindus, if we need to choose one event in a year which we need to celebrate, that is Shankara Jayanti. Because we have got so many festivals and so many events in our calendar, in our Hindu calendar. The reason being, today we are all following Hinduism because of Adi Shankara. In fact, Kanchi Mahaperyava has clearly said, this is the only thing which everybody must celebrate. It's the one thing which you cannot miss it. Because Adi Shankara is playing a very important part of the entire history, the modern history, where when our Bharat was swayed by other religion and cultures, and he re-established Advaita. And some people think Adi Shankara was the beginner of the Advaita, which I would like to refute. And some people call it as a Shankara philosophy, which is not the case. Shankara only re-established Advaita. And that is why we are all able to be following the Sanatana Dharma, the Vaidika Dharma, the Veda, and the prescription which is given by the Vedas. So we all should thank Adi Shankaracharya for the immense work he has done in the short life of 32 years. And as you know, Adi Shankara, after taking permission from his mother, and then went to towards north and met his future guru, Govinda Bhagavatpada. And then he asked, "Who are you?" Then that is the time this Nirvana Shatkam was given, where Adi Shankara introduced himself. Even though it seems Govinda Bhagavatpada said, "You don't need any guru," but he has to have a formal guru, because as we know, Adi Shankara is not a normal human being. We consider him as the avatar of the Lord Shiva himself, Lord Dakshinamurti himself. So such is the important part Adi Shankara has played in our life. And as you know, Shankara means Sham plus Karati. Sham means Mangalam, prosperity, auspiciousness. And the person who is a giver of auspiciousness, that's what is Shankara. And Bhagavatpada. Bhagavatpada means what? Na Bhagavatam Padayate Bhagavatpada. Bhagavantam Padayate Bhagavatpada. That means one who guides towards the Lord. That means one who is a spiritual guide, who is a spiritual master. Now let us talk about the Nirvana Shatkam. And this is a advanced text. This is actually a Nididhyasanam text. But it has got the utility even for the beginners. Nirvanam means, simply put it, moksha. Okay, Nirvanam means, simply put it, moksha. The non-coverability, otherwise it's definitely, it is all-pervasive. That is about the consciousness. So we call it as a moksha. In fact, we have seen in Gita also, Brahma Nirvanam, second chapter, fifth chapter, we have seen the word Brahma Nirvanam. So Nirvanam is moksha. And before we dwell on the text proper, I would like to summarize the entire Sanatana Dharma roadmap in a short way, and then tell you where this is placed. I told you it is in Nididhyasana. The very purpose of human goal is to understand oneself and live happily here and now. Unlike other philosophies, in Advaita philosophy, we clearly say there is something called Jivan Muktihi, because all other philosophies talk about something which is afterwards, which we do not know where we are going to be. But here and now, once I understand my true nature, which people call it as a realization, I would say understanding the self, that I am the Atma, I am not this body-mind complex, and this Atma is the only one which is all-pervading, and it is there in everybody and every being. Once I have this understanding, I can develop a number of corollaries, and I will be able to relax and live very happily. In spite of corona or anything which is there, I will have a very relaxed mindset, because I will be able to face the future in my life in a bold way. That means I develop a equanimity, a samatvam, which is based on the knowledge. And based on the knowledge, when I develop that equanimity and strength, inner strength, I get purnatvam, swatantram, and samatvam. I call it as a PSS. So once you get it, then the life is going to be excellent. So every human being is born with ignorance. I mean, there are exceptions. Let us leave the exceptions. Generally speaking, all of us are born with ignorance. That is understandable. But only difference between animals and human beings are, we have been given the special, the sixth sense, which is the buddhi, which is fully matured, unlike the other animals and insects. So we have got the answer key in the face, in the name of the Veda, the user manual. When God has created this entire Srishti, entire Jagat, na anda sharasharam, and obviously he has to give a user manual. Like you go and buy even a small eye drop in the pharmacy, and you get a full user manual, 15 languages, how to use it, how to store it, etc. And having created such a wonderful creation, obviously God has to give a user manual. So he has developed, that is what we call it as a Vedas, that is what we call it as a Vaidika Dharma or Sanatana Dharma. So every human being is supposed to follow this Vaidika Dharma and realize his true nature and live happily. As Bhagavan says, Parasvaram Bhavayantaha, and we live with the support each other and nourish with each other and live happily. But most of the people do not do it. And only very few people come to Vedanta, understand and realize, and then get the full benefit of these scriptures. So typically, for a person who starts the journey, there are basically three steps. Because we should know where our problem is, then we should know the goal, and we should know the path. This is all three steps. So our problem is what? Because I have got a strong ahankara and mamakara, me and mineness, and I have got a strong ragadvesha, and my strong ragadvesha is likes and dislikes, and due to ragadvesha, the likes and dislikes, I have got a strong attachment, and that leads to becoming selfish, and every action I do, it generates either a papa or a punya, and the papa and punya leads to punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. This is a typical cycle of an ajnani jiva, an ignorant jiva. And the answer, as I told you, is available only for manushya, not for animals. So what is the answer? As a jiva, what is the shastra says is there are three steps. First one is, the first problem is the ignorance. As I told you, the ignorance is the first problem, which we call it as a malam, which is called as a malam, otherwise the dirt, the six enemies, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, mada, matsaryam. So the six enemies are there, and the antidote for that is the, what is the antidote? Karma yoga. So you follow the principles of karma yoga and develop the chitta shuddhi. Chitta shuddhi means a calm mind, a tranquil mind, a clear mind, a thinking mind. So this is the first step. So first follow karma yoga, and then gradually move towards upasana yoga. What is that? Normally, we are very, very extroverted in nature. Because we are hyperactive, we want to go out and achieve so many things and then do so many things. And also, we have got lots of waveringness. Now, as Bhagavan says in Gita, chanchalam hi manakrishna pramathi balavati dridam. So we have got what we call it as a vikshepam, which is the waveringness, because we are always confused. When you have got choices, you are confused. Even when you go to supermarket, you have got confused which one you need to buy. So we are always in a state of confusion in terms of decision making. So we need to overcome this waveringness, and that can be done by upasana yoga, otherwise called meditation upon the Ishta Devata, the Ekarupa Devata, whichever Devata you have got. You meditate upon the Lord and develop the oneness. Now, as Bhagavan says, Vyavasa Yatmika Buddhihi Ekeha Kurunandana. So obviously you will have a single pointed focus. And once you get the mind ready through karma yoga and upasana yoga, we call it as a fourfold qualification to go to jnana yoga. What all the fourfold qualification you will get by following karma and upasana yoga? What you get is sadhana chatushtayam, we call it. What is sadhana chatushtayam? Vivekam, vairagyam, mumukshutvam, samadhi shatka sampatti. Samadhi shatka sampatti means shamaha, damaha, uparama, titiksha, shraddha, samadhana. So you will get these qualifications. Like we have got, if you have to go to a college, we have got a professor in front of us. If professor will not admit somebody who is coming from the elementary school, obviously you require a degree to go to the master's program, or a master's to go to the PhD. Similarly, for Vedanta, normally you are supposed to have the prepared mind before you go and study the Shastra. That is the original thing. But we are coming through a back door, it is okay. We start reading the Bhagavad Gita text. What you do? You first develop the understanding, because we are all curious in the modern days. Hey, what is in it for me? What will I get if I study? So, in those days, when the Shishya goes to the Guru, the Shishya will not ask, when will I get the Jnanam? When will you teach me? He will never ask. Okay, sometimes the Guru will say, you go and take care of all the cows for the next 10 years. Then he'll come back. So, this Guru will assess the preparation of a person. Even in Kathopanishad, you can see, Nachiketas was tested by Yamadharma Raja when he went to Nachiketas. So whether he has got the qualification before he gives him the Atma Jnana. But nowadays, we get the jnanam knowledge first, and then we have to improve the sadhana chatushtayam along the way. Otherwise, the jnanam is there. I have got a theoretical knowledge of what is Atma. And I can eloquently talk, I can give verses, I can give discourses like this. And what will happen is, I will not be able to assimilate it. Still, my personality doesn't change. I still have the ragadvesha, I still have anxieties, I still have fear. Everything is as it is. That is why some people, when they don't change and they're going and memorizing verses, people surrounding them will say, what is the use of you going to Gita class for 30 years? So the very purpose is, it is okay to study the Gita, which is the fundamental text, or Viveka Chudamani. You start with this, get the roadmap, get the where the baseline, where the roadmap, what is our goal. So our baseline is what? We are all having the anxiety and Kama Krodha Ragadvesha. And what is the roadmap? Karma Yoga, Upasana, Jnana Yoga. And then what is the benefit? Moksha is Mukti, Jivan Mukti. Here and now I am happy. So after getting the Sadhana Chatushtayam, I go to Jnana Yoga. In the Jnana Yoga, you got three sub-steps. The first one is Shravanam, which is what we call it as systematic study of the scriptures, systematic sequential study of the scriptures for a lengthy period of time under the guidance of a competent live acharya. My Guruji used to say every word is important. So one should follow a systematic study, and then you will have a lot of doubts. So once the doubts come, then you will have a clarity. I mean, you will have a clarification done by the Guru. And as you go through the scripture itself, you will get a lot of doubts cleared. And you can see when you go to second chapter of Gita, you will have a number of doubts coming up. But after some time, you get cleared about all the doubts. So you'll have absolute clarity on the whole thing. Then what is the thing? The last step is the Nididhyasanam. Nididhyasanam is the assimilation. As we normally say, the eater food will not give the nourishment. It is the food which is assimilated will give the nourishment. So similarly, you should be able to internalize the teaching, and it has to become my core personality. That means I should not only believe, I should say I am the Atma with the full conviction. I am not the body-mind complex. I am the Atma which is ever present, and I do not have any birth or any death. I should be able to give with full conviction. And once you do this, then you will be able to enjoy the tranquility inside, even though you are doing the transaction outside. So in the outside world, you can put a various veshas, various costumes, and you can play different roles. But internally, you are very well aware, I am the Atma, I am not this body-mind complex. The body-mind has got the shat-vikaram, all the changes will happen. One day, this body-mind will be dropped off, but I am going to be ever-present. So this understanding is called Nididhyasanam. So Nirvana Shatkam is a text which is beautifully describing this Nididhyasanam, where I am able to internalize it. So for the beginners, even without knowing the meaning, you can start memorizing these shlokas and then start chanting every day to begin with. And over a period, as you are going through the roadmap of Vedanta, you will be able to have the meaning of each shloka. Because normally we take one shloka 1 hour. That is the kind of a depth which is got, which we are going to do it in 15 minutes. So the idea is, you internalize it first, memorize it, and then keep chanting it for a beginner. Over a period, you will get the meaning. And as you come to the Jnana Yoga and Nididhyasanam, you will be able to assimilate it better. For those who are in this journey for quite some time, then this is a beautiful Vedantic text, which you can every day chant. And then qualify yourself or compare yourself against what is said in this text. Am I behaving like this when I transact in the world? Because worldly transactions, of course, as I told you, put a costume and act. But are you going to emotionally get connected and get upset or not? That is something you need to figure it out. So this text is giving fundamentally the ability to internalize the teaching completely and realize or experience the full benefit, which is called Jivan Muktihi. And one point I wanted to tell you here, this people often say, I want to have an Atma Anubhava. Atma is myself. So it is not the question of Anubhava, because Atma is not the third person. So many people, even coming to Advaita, talk about the Atmananda Anubhava. So I would like to again clarify, based on whatever I have learned from my guru, Atma cannot, the very proof of you are Atma is your own life. Na, Shrotrasya Shrotram Mano Manaha. So it is very clearly you are the Atma itself. So there is no proof for you have the Atma or you are experiencing the Atma, because Atma cannot be objectified and experienced. So what is the process of Nididhyasana is, I am going to internalize myself that I am the Atma. So the scripture presents the whole thing. Initially, Prasad says you are the body mind, then you have got the Atma. Then they say, no, I am the Atma, I have got the body mind complex. Then the next step is, the same Atma is there in everybody. Then finally, what you say is, the same Atma is everywhere. And very last point is, there is only Atma or consciousness or Brahman. Everything is the Mithya Jagat. So this is the ultimate. So it has got 4 or 5 steps. Each step is a long process. So you have to understand this clearly. So this shloka, this shatkam, Nirvana Shatkam, is negating and come to the highest step of Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya Jivo Brahmaiva Naparaha. That concept is beautifully presented by the principle of Neti Neti. Neti Neti means what? Not this, not this. So I am negating everything in my life, and then finally I arrive at that I am the consciousness. Because as we know, consciousness cannot be objectified, and it has only be understood, cannot be objectified and looked at it. So how do you understand it? Because whether you know it or not, you are already the Atma only. But what is happening is, I'm removing everything and I'm able to understand I'm the Atma. So you require 2 key principles. How do I arrive at this thing? There are 2 important principles. First thing is, whatever I experience, I am not. Whatever I experience, I am not. So if I experience the cell phone, I am not the cell phone. If I experience the computer, I am not the computer. Very easy. Then when you come closer to your body, I am experiencing the body, because I know there is a knee, there is a ache, and there is a pain, everything. So I know I am not the physical body. That is the second step. Then I am also able to see my own mood, which is I am angry, I am confused, I am cheerful. You know, you have got various moods which you are able to see. So you are able to see your own mind also. You are able to read your own mind. So you are able to negate the world. You are able to experience and objectify the body. You are able to experience and objectify the your own mind. So once the 3 are objectified, what is left out? Otherwise, put it this way, which is one which is object, which is able to see these things? What is the one which is able to see your own mind? Because in the darkness, I'm able to experience the darkness and able to wade through that. So I know I'm not aware of something, so I'm able to do it. That is what we call it as a consciousness principle. Now, coming to that, the same thing. Here, what is the thing is, we are negating everything in this text. So the last line of the text, which clearly says is, Aham Shivaha, Chit Ananda Rupam, Chidananda Rupam, Shivoham, Shivoham. It is the last line which is common for all the 6 shlokas which is there in the Nirvana Shatkam. Shatkam means 6. So Nirvana means Moksha. So there are only 6 stanzas for the Moksha. So Chidananda Rupam, Shivoham, Shivoham. Shivaha, Shivaha means auspicious, Shuddha, Mangalam. That is another name for Brahman. Where this name come from? You can go to Mandukya Upanishad, 7th mantra. Na Shantam Shivam Advaitam Chaturtam Manyante Sa Atma Sa Vijayaha. I am the Shivaha. So it is very clearly there in the Upanishad itself. So Acharya brings that very clearly. And what is the feature of this? It is Chit, consciousness. It is Ananda. Of course, the Sat is omitted, which you have to add it. So Sat Chit Ananda Swarupam. That is what we get. Now coming to the shloka, first 2 shlokas. The first 2 shlokas, which starts with Mano Buddhya Hankara Chitta Dinaham Nacha Shrotra Jikve Nacha Grana Netre Nacha Vyoma Bhumir Natejo Navayuhu Chidaranda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham Nacha Prana Nacha Prana Samyo Navai Pancha Vayuhu Nava Sapta Datuhu Nava Pancha Kosha Navakpani Padam Nashopastapayuhu Chidaranda Rupa Shivoham Shivoham. So the first 2 stanzas verses, what this does is, it negates the Stula Sukshma Karna Shariram. I cannot go into the every word of it, due to paucity of time, this is a summary. The first two verses negate the gross body, the subtle body, and the causal body of an individual, the jiva, and says, I am not that, this thing. That is what is the meaning of the first two slokas. Then the third sloka, Name dvesha raho, name lobha moho, madho naiva me naiva matsarya bhavaha, na dharmo na charto na kamo na mokshaha, chidananda rupa shivoham shivoham. So this summarizes, I am not any of the emotions which I exhibit. I told you six enemies, kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madha, matsarya, I am not. And the four pursuits, the purusharthas, I am not. Dharma, artha, kama, moksha, I am not. Very clearly it is negating and claiming myself to be the aham shivam, aham shivam. The reason it is repeated twice is to reinforce, this is the only fact. Normally when you see repeatedly, you can say, why is it repeated? Because repetition means reinforcement. Then go to fourth shloka. Beautiful shloka. Na punyam, na punyam, na papam, na saukyam, na dukkam, na mantro, na tirtam, na veda, na yajna. Aham bhojanam naiva bhojyam na bhokta, chidananda rupa shivoham shivoham. So what does it mean? The fourth stanza says, I am negating the subject, object, instrument. We call it as a triputi, a triangular thing. Because everything has there's a subject, there's an object, there's an instrument by which only we transact in the world. This is referred either it experiencing or getting the knowledge or doing an action. There's always a triangular format. So we negate it. Then what is the other one we're saying? Aham bhojanam naiva bhojyam na bhokta. That's what it is. And then second one, what it is negating is all the other dharma karyam which you do. Yajna, dhana, tapas, everything we do. And all those things are for punyam. And all those punyam papam is only for the jiva. For atma, there is no punyam or papam. So I am negating all the punyam papam. And also the mantram, tirtham, veda, yajna. It is to be very carefully understood here. That as an Advaitin, when I say I am negating means it is intellectually. But as a individual who is still in the world, I must continue to do the work as a loka sangraha. So we should never renounce our basic duties to the life. So this is very important. We keep the Advaita Bhavana and then we act in the world. That is very important. Because the shloka number 5 is going to say, I don't have any relationship at all. Okay. Na mrityurna shanka na meja tibetaha pita naiva me naiva mata na janmaha. Na bhandur na mitram gurur naiva sishyam chidananda rupa shivoham shivoham. Here all the relationships are also broken. The previous one, we said all the spiritual, all these, religious rites, you say, I am not. And here I say, I don't have any relationship. This has to be understood very, very carefully that as an individual, as an atma, I do not have any relationship. All the relationships are like a rail sneha. Like when you are seeing another passenger in the train and you go with him. So it is like that. So, but what we should do? We cannot bring this Advaita into the transactional world. We should keep the Advaita Jnanam and transact in the world with the Dvaita. The world is full of Dvaita. The world, even though it's Mithya, it is real for many other people. For you and I, it is a Mithya. What is the definition of Mithya? Appears to be real, appears to be experientially factual, actually not true. Actually, it is all Mithya. Like a dream example. Like a dream, at the time of dream, you feel like it is a real dream, but when you wake up to the reality, it is not the dream is not true. Similarly, the whole Mithya world is, I am aware, it is not the real thing. It is like a mirage. But world outside does not know. So you should never bring the Advaita to the world outside. You must be very, very careful. Na bhava dvaitam sada kuryat kriya dvaitam na karhijit. Advaitam trishilokeshu na dvaitam guruna sah. That means you must keep the Advaita in the deep in the mind. But you should never bring that into the transacting world. And what you do? You should never confuse yourself or confuse the world. Okay. If you say the entire world as all the three worlds as with Advaita, but what is the thing is, we must continue to have a reverential attitude towards the Guru. So how do I transact in the world with this Jnanam? That means I should follow Dharma. So as an Advaitin, who is a realized Jnani, or who is a person who has understood the self, who is a Jeevan Mukta, otherwise called Parabhakta, otherwise called Gunatita, as said in Gita, as Adhiraha or Panditaha. So these are all synonyms of a Jnani. How I will deal with this? I will continue to do a good, and I can be a Grahastha Jnani or a formal Sannyasi Jnani also. But when we are all Grahasthas, most of us. So what I do? I continue to be in the Grahastha Ashrama. I can get this journey even in the Grahastha Ashrama itself. There's no reason that you have to take Akaro. That is also very clear. No, because Janaka and Ashwapati and others have done it. Many, many people have done it. So you can do this. So how do I do it? I continue to be in this path and I transact in the world with the Dharma. Dharma is the core central theme which I should never give up. So because I have practiced Dharma in a totality when I was a Karma Yogi itself. So after transcending the Karma Upasana Yoga, so Jnani will always never slip in the Dharma. He will always be on the dharmic path only. So keep Dharma for the worldly transactions. Understand every event, every people, person you are coming through, or every material possession you have got, everything will pass away. Everything will come, everything will go. Similarly, I means this body mind also, will have a limited period. It will come and it will go. So have this in your mind. Then the final concluding shloka says, Aham nirvikalpo nirahara rupo vibhutva cha sarvatra sarvendriyanam na cha sangatam naiva muktir nameyah chidananda rupa shivoham shivoham. So that is why he concludes this. So I do not have any form. I am formless. I am changeless. I do not have any modification. What is that? The sixfold modification. Now, what is it? Asti, jayate, vardate, viparinamate, apakshiyate, vinashyati. So I don't have any modifications. I pervade in and through everything. And then I am neither liberated nor bonded. So this is something you have to be very, very carefully understood. You know, sometimes it will be confusing. And there is one more version for this particular shloka, which is also similar to this thing. There is another version, which also I have seen it in the web. So, Aham nirvikalpo nirahara rupo vibhur vyapya sarvatra sarvendriyanam sadame samatvam na muktirna bandha chidananda rupam shivoham shivoham. So, sadame samatvam. So, adame samatvam means I am ever in equanimity. I can accept everything because nothing is affecting me. And there is nothing called mukti, there is nothing called bondage. Because the Jeevan Mukti as a term is only from the standpoint of Ajnan. This is a very, very subtle concept. Once I have the full understanding, I have assimilated, I am the Atma. So for me, there is no question of Jeevan Mukti, Videha Mukti, it doesn't matter at all. In fact, it has no relevance because I am Atma, I have understood, I am clear. So only from the Ajnani standpoint, the terms Jeevan Mukti, Videha Mukti are given. So we need to be very clear about this particular thing. And finally, what I do? I be always in the state of this knowledge and ever there, and nobody shake my knowledge, and I have a wonderful life. So to summarize it, understand the five-step process. For those who are in the initial stages of qualification, go through Karma Yoga, Upasana Yoga, then Shravana, Manana, Nididhyasana, and systematic study under the guidance of one Acharya is very important, so that you get all the glossaries correct, all the terms correct, and everything is right before you jump into various spiritual jumping. You know, that is what today in the internet world, people keep on jumping it. Stop it. And Shraddha is very, very important, because as we said, Atma cannot be proved by science. And only Shastra is the only one which reveals the Atma. Because already there's a disclaimer. It is Achintyam Aprameyam. So it is not available for the human perception. So Veda is the sixth Pramanam. So that is where the Shraddha is required. And other one is enjoy the journey. Don't feel offended or don't feel guilty. Forget all the past mistakes. So don't have any guilty feeling of the past. Never fancy the future. And live in the present and enjoy the journey. And last but not the least, keep the Advaita Jnanam inside and transact in the world with the, which is the Dvaita world, transact in the dharmic way. With this, let me conclude the talk and I'm ready to take any question answers.
Thank you very much, Raviji. It was wonderful. I think you were clear step by step you created a nice foundation for Nirvana Satakam, and you went through the context and the various slokas and ended with excellent suggestions for us. There are about 3-4 questions. One question is, why are we born with ignorance of our real nature? Almost everyone born in this world will need sadhana to realize their self. So why is that a case? Wouldn't it be wonderful if everybody is born with the realization of the self itself?
Oh, fantastic question. We call it as one of the common FAQs. So we are born with ignorance because the Shastra says, as Gita puts it, Vasamsi Jirnani Yata Vihaya, once the physical body is dropped in the previous birth, the Sukshma Karna Shariram, we call it as a mind, and everything together travels with the reflected consciousness, and you still have the what do you call it as the Sanjita Karma. And the Sanjita Karma has to be exhausted again. So you only by again coming as a Jiva. It can be an animal or it can be a human being. But you can again exhaust your the Sanchita Karma, which is there, fixed deposits of, I call it as a fixed deposit of Papa Punya, which is called Sanjita. So that has to fructify as Prarabdha. So only when you come to the Prarabdha, comes fructifies as a Manushya. Only in the Manushya Janma, you will be able to break the cycle. Not as an animal. This is one point you should understand. The second point is, as a Manushya only, I have got the, not only able to understand the and break the cycle, and for the animals, they cannot break the cycle because they only exhaust the prarabdha. They do not accumulate any papa punya. Whereas as a human being, if I don't go through the scriptural study and shift my attitude towards atma, then still with the body mind, then I continue to generate papa punya, which is again attached to the jiva. So what we call it as a agami. So why I am born? It is not, don't blame the God. I am born with ignorance because I wasted my previous Manushya opportunity. The simple answer is, I wasted my human birth, which was given in the earlier Janma sometime. Because one Upanishad says, how many Janmas I have taken? It says, you have taken so many Janmas as like trying to count the number of sand grains on the seabed. Right. So we have wasted quite a few Manushya Janmas. At least let this be the last one.
Excellent answer. I remember even in Manisha Panchakam, he says, Prarabdhaya Samarpitam Svavapuhu. By my own fire, I'll burn the Prarabdha Karma. So,
yeah.
Excellent. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Elaborating some of those. There is another question. Can you please explain a little bit more Sadhana Chatushtayam? You touched upon it in the beginning, if you can elaborate a little bit.
Yeah, there are fourfold qualification. I did not give the English meaning due to time constraint. Viveka means discriminative faculty. The first Viveka is discrimination is what is dharma and what is adharma, right and wrong. This is a very basic for every human being should have. Then as a Vedantin, if you want to go to Vedanta and start studying, you must have the second discrimination, what is nityam, what is anityam, what is permanent, what is ephemeral and fleeting. So if you start analyzing and everything in the world is anityam, ephemeral, fleeting, changing, and it will have a beginning and end, and except Atma, the consciousness, you will understand this. So this is what is called Viveka. Once you have got the Viveka, then you develop the Vairagyam. Vairagyam is what you call it as a dispassion. So first one is discrimination. Second one is called dispassion. So dispassion means it is not giving up and taking to sannyasa. Dispassion means develop a internal detachment. As Bhagavan says in Krishna, in 5th chapter, Nyayasa Nitya Sanyasi, Yona Dveshtina Kangshati. So develop an inner detachment. As my Guruji used to say, convert everything into preferences. We can still, as a Grihastha, can have Artha and Kama. You can earn and enjoy. Scripture never says no. You can only doing is, you have to do it in an ethical way. Earn as much you want in an ethical way. Enjoy as much you want in an ethical way. But understand, all these things will pass away. So when you do it, you don't put a binding desires. Convert the binding desires to non-binding desire. That is what is called it as a vairagya. Otherwise called dispassion. Then the third one is mumukshutva. That is the desire for moksha. Moksha icha. So we are not saying desireless state. We require a desire to even for studying scriptures. So the desire is a sattvic desire, like a good cholesterol. Like we have got good cholesterol and bad cholesterol. Yes, this is called a good cholesterol. So we must have the desire. So the desire is called mumukshutva. Then the fourth one is there are six things in the fourth samadhi shatka sampatti, which is shamaha, which is sensory, which is a shamaha means the mind channelization or regulation. Okay. And damaha, sensory channelization or regulation. Shamaha, damaha. Then uparama, ability to withdraw. Like the tortoise. Na, yada samharde chayam kurmongani vasarvaha. So uparama. So shamaha, damaha, uparama. Then titiksha. That means the patience. That means develop the samatva bhava, certain choiceless things. Now, if you don't have titiksha during corona, what will happen? You will only suffer. You have to face it. And all of us are stuck. So you must develop the titiksha. So shamaha, damaha, uparama, titiksha, shraddha. Shraddha, I talked about it earlier. That's Veda is the sixth instrument of knowledge. The five instrument cannot crack. So is the sixth instrument is the Veda. And have a astikya buddhi, we call it. So pramanya buddhi. Veda is the pramanya buddhi is called shraddha. The last one is samadhana. Samadhana means concentration. Because one should have a concentration. From extroverted stage in Karma Yoga, one goes to introverted stage. And only in the introverted stage, you will be able to develop concentration. Because this Atmajnanam requires lot of internalization. First of all, vicharam. First of all, understanding requires concentration. In the Upanishad class, if you take the mind away for 1 minute, you will lose the concept. No, you require a complete concentration. And then you should be able to assimilate, you require a concentration. So these are all the samadhi shakka sampatti. Discipline, we call it. Yeah, thank you.
I appreciate you elaborating it. There is one more question. You talked about papa and punya to be only for jiva, not for the atman. So what is the difference between jiva and atman?
Okay. Atman, see, what I would request is for the people who are having the questions. There's a beautiful work called Introduction to Vedanta. And which has been given as a talk, which is compiled by Swamiji, Swami Paramarthananda's talks. Have been compiled as Introduction to Vedanta. And this is only an 80-page double-spacing document. I would request you to go through. It will give you all the answers to many of your questions. But I'll tell you, your question here is the Papa Punya, right? So the Papa Punya is for the Jiva, because Jiva means, technically speaking, the Atma, we call it as a original consciousness. The Jiva is nothing but the original consciousness is all-pervading. That all-pervading consciousness there in me also. We call it as a reflected consciousness. That is what is enlivening my mind. The mind in learns enlivening my body. See, like a electricity, which is pervading everywhere, but electricity is all pervading. But what happens is the electricity is pervading into a fan and then gives you a cool air. If pervading to air conditioner, it gives you temperature cool. It goes to a heater, it makes it hot. So similarly, every jiva is like an instrument and all pervading electricity like atma, when it is reflecting in the body mind, then that is what is called jiva. So jiva. So in the jiva, the papa punya is only for the jiva. The like electricity, atma is akarta abhokta. So it does not have, it is neither the doer nor the enjoyer. It is only a sakshi or a witness, or it is like the light which is pervading. Like for example, the light is pervading in the hall. I don't realize it because when I put a hand only, I realize there's a light. Otherwise, when I withdraw the hand, I don't see the light. So light is there. Without the light, I cannot do the transaction. So light is the one which is giving the, which is a sakshi. Similarly, atma is the light for the, when you see the light, with the help of light only, you are able to see the hand. Similarly, atma is a sakshi principle. So that is the concept.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We'll take a last couple of questions. One is, how do we live in the Dvaitic world? You said that we live in the Dvaita world. Is there any suggestion on living effectively in the Dvaita world?
Very easy. Very easy. You start becoming a Karma Yogi first.
Okay.
You don't need to even go to Jnana. Krishna says very clearly to Arjuna, very clearly in the second chapter, when he started introducing the Karma, Sukha Dukke Samaya Kritva Labha Labho Jaya Jayo. What he says is, develop the equanimity, a Samatva Bhava. The first step of spiritual progress, the first ladder is two things. First one is have an ethical living. Wherever you have got a doubt in ethics, ask some elders for help or go to the scriptures, and then scriptures will give you the answer which is right and which is not right. So ethical living is the first one. Second thing is, even the scripture itself says you don't need to come to the entire ladder. It is not for everyone. So what you do is you earn and enjoy dharmically and as much as possible. Yeah. But understand, you will go through various turbulence in the life. Even life is so smooth, you will be facing the death that nobody can avoid. So what you do is you develop an equanimity in choiceless situations. That's what Bhagavan beautifully put it. Karmanyeva adhikaraste mahaphaleshu kadachana. That's why he said samatvam yoga uchyate. So you can be a religious person and have a ethical values, but what you do is you need not come to further steps. The first step of yoga, spiritual ladder is what? Karma yoga, in which the sub step is samatvam yoga uchyate, develop the equanimity. That means Ishvara prasada buddhi. Because I have got a choice only to a certain extent, I cannot control it. So develop the prasada buddhi. That itself will give you lots of happiness and peace.
So there are quite a few questions actually. I'm just picking one randomly to make it last so that we can go to the next talk. That Vega, the question of what is the original papa or punya that caused the creation of first amoeba?
Again, the standard question again.
Yeah.
So there's no, creation is a cyclic process. Short answer. Creation is not a linear process. Because our mind normally thinks it is a linear process. It is a cyclic process. So for a circle, you do not have the beginning and end. Similarly, this creation is a misnomer. We call it as a manifestation and unmanifestation. That is the right term to be used. So we use the wrong term and then get confused. So there is no creation at all. What happens is, at some point of time, the Pralaya is described. Okay, when the Brahma's various life cycle are given. So in the Pralaya comes, everything is dissolved. That means all the punya papa of all the jivas are in a cold storage. Like for example, you got this thing and put it in the cold storage, again come back and use it, right? So similarly, everything goes into cold storage or resolved. And again, when the next Srishti comes, everything comes back.
Yeah.
The classic example is, every day we have the experience of dream. So in this deep sleep, when you go to deep sleep every day, all your whatever you are, everything is resolved. Your mind is not functioning, your buddhi is not functioning, except the breathing, everything is gone at that deep sleep state. But when you get back, how are you able to wake up and then understand, I am this so and so, I have got this title? That is because of the chittam. Similarly, it is not a creation, it's a cyclic process. Everything gets resolved and again comes back. Avyakta advyakteya sarvaha prabhavantya harahame.
Thank you very much, Sri Raviji. There are lots of questions and there have been a lot of comments saying it is excellent talk. You have given a really wonderful roadmap. And some people are asking about recording of your talk already. We should be able to get it. Generally, we are getting it within 24 hours, 36 hours. The recording will appear on the Advaita Academy YouTube channel. And we really appreciate your presence and look forward to hearing more of your talks.
Sure. Thank you very much. If anybody wants to reach me out, they can call me or WhatsApp me at +65. 65 is the country code Singapore. 9455-1063. My name is R.S. Ravi. So you can reach out to me. I'll be happy to answer all your questions further. Thank you very much.
Wonderful gift. Thank you for the extra gift you have given to the panelists. Now, I hope you have the number and you can reach out to him if you have questions. And thank you again for an enlightening talk.